Okay, so pause. So let us continue. My name is Matti Schubert, and I'm working on the office collaboration. I'm still the chair of the Advanced Document Collaboration Subcommittee of OASIS. Well, there was a break you mentioned. This is in progress. We need implementations. The OASIS requires 2 implementations. So this is the sum up of my work for the last 6 years. So let me try to guide you through. First of all, a little provocative questions. In 50 years, do you believe that LibreOffice is still your favorite editor? Any takers? I really thought hard about it, and how can we answer this? And it all comes down to questions. I shouldn't say yes and nothing to you. But in general, it depends on if LibreOffice is able to fulfill the feature set, which is on Vogue in 50 years, right? So, 1976 BI was on Vogue, right? Text editor. Today, nobody, maybe some people are using it, but it's getting down and down. So, to me, collaboration is probably the most important feature that is upcoming, right? Because we live in a connected world, and everybody got at least, I believe, most of us got 2 computers, a smartphone and a laptop. And so we are collaborating even with ourselves, and we have to sync the documents that we're working on. And that's becoming a problem because most of the software is from the 80s where we were living from a floppy disk and we load and save from floppy disk. So the switch of parallel. So let me define real-time collection. There's, I looked it up in Wiki, and real-time editor has 2 modes, which is quite interesting because mostly one of those modes is forgotten. It's written in general. These both modes can and should be supported. And the 2 modes are, one is like we all have in mind when we come up with real-time modes, like Google Docs or Collabora online, where we have 2 courses and we can work at the same time. But the second mode, and mostly forgot, very important, is where we can copy, we work on a copy, and we can offline, like software developers, and after a while, maybe a weekend, maybe a month, we sync back, we merge back, right? And basically, both are quite similar. And the thing is, the main difference here is that while both of them, all the copies have to be similar in the end, so go about collaboration. The real-time mode, for convenience purposes, provides extra fixes of merge prefix. Think about if I'm working on a cell and you delete the table, it's a merge prefix, right? And so there's no sign coming out in red alert, so you have to fix this merge thing. No, it should be very convenient. You can, the cursor flying and you will never have to deal with it. That's not a problem, it's wonderful. But the non-real mode is where you have to explicitly resolve, for software developers, resolve all the conflicts manually. So the real-time mode is very nice if you're working with a bunch of people, colleagues you're trusting. And the other one is we don't trust the other one. You don't have a control of anything, like legal departments. So summing up this example is the real-time mode is what comes first to mind. The second one is often forgotten, and I believe that most of the money is there, right? And money drives everything. So we have to focus and think about the second mode and support that. So how does real-time collaboration work? And in general, it's funny. One of the very few things that all the developers, I worked on 3 or 4 web offices, the first thing that all developers agree on is that everyone said, we cannot send documents because we work in a very, very rich document. And we set this document for every keystroke that we do, that it loads all the time, it doesn't scale it. So it's, but still we are doing this all the time now, we're sending documents by email. It's like source code repositories, for software developers, it's like zipping their developers, like software developers zipping their source code repositories, that's it, right? And telling, by the way, here are my changes to my work that I worked last month. It's very hard because you have to merge it back in one document. So, how they do it? They dispatch changes. You don't really know about how Google Docs do it, right? You know how Etherpad is, as far as I know, Etherpad team is being bought up by Google once and they made it in closed source. But I realized that it works best if you don't send syntax or text, but send it semantics, like with phone, your colleague can say, by the way, in the 3rd paragraph, we changed this character, right? That's how we're dealing by far. So the most problem is, if you got a document back, the first question you're asking is, what have you changed? And there's currently no way in telling this in an interoperable way, so many applications could implement it, because all we have implemented or specified are file formats, like the ODF standard and HTML and docx and everything is only docbook, is only standardizing the file state. There's no way in explaining a diff. And all Git is doing a line basically. They're totally agnostic to semantic, which is, doesn't work so well in ODF documents because they can be in one line or in multiple lines, and the XML differ, but it's logically the same. So we have to do it differently. So how can we solve this problem and how does the feature look like? You can see we have multiple users using different ODF applications and they're dispatching ODF changes. And an ODF change could be like, oh, by the way, I entered a new fourth paragraph. And the other one said, oh, by the way, I make the second paragraph blue. And so at the same time, the third one gets multiple commands. And this is how it should like, and this is how we should specify all the stuff. So is it possible that this becomes a standard? Well, when you think about it, it's already an effective standard because you might be surprised that you find in every Office application the same logical things like a table, a column, cell, image, and hyperlinks, and you can insert, delete them, and modify them. So the user changes do already exist. All the specifications are just underspecified because it's work. And so all we have to do is now to implement it. And how about a prototype? Yeah, that'd be cool. And by the way, we have one. Because the prototype file is supposed to be a last feature to implement this green box. I would call it a black box, but okay, this one is green. But what you're doing is you give it a text document, ODT, and it's being sequenced, let's call it a sequence, it's being serialized to a sequence of user, like the user would have changed it from the top to the beginning or edited it. Okay? So why are we doing it? Because then you can send these documents, kids out of JSON, to web office. And the web office will not know is this by a different user, by a different web office, or is it by the document format. The web office does not know anything about ODF. It only knows changes, and every user change is being tracked as well, and it's being dispatched to the other things. This slide, for instance, Open Exchange, where I worked a few years, is dealing and how it's being built. So, but it's available, and but yet, it's just a module, it's a backend module. So how about a real prototype that you can use have as an end user? I tried, but let me give you an example. So let's say we have a Vim, not VI, it's a Vim, okay? And it's an ODF application. Well, last time I checked, it wasn't an ODF application. But think about it. What about if you map all the parts to this Vim, the changes, that it's capable of? And there are only two things that are capable of, obvious text. But you can emulate a paragraph by line, okay? So in the end, you can edit the text and merge it back in a real document. So like, oh, I've got here, I call it a feature bridge, right? It's mapping, it's doing the mapping between the feature that the Vim doesn't know. I map something in position 1-1, and they got it back at 3-1. Then, because, and here's going, this is how the document might look like, and this is the semantic tree. At position 1 is the table, at position 2 is the image, and at position 3 there's this paragraph. So while the W, because Vim doesn't see anything, does not know anything about the table, does not know anything about the image, it will think that the W is at position 1-1, while LibreOffice knows it's 3-1. So what we are doing, we are putting these unknown features back in and moving it out during the collaboration, okay? We can do it more efficiently, but that's the basic rule. So, knowing this can be there's something more exciting than Vim. I tried. I thought, how about CK Editor 5? CK Editor 5 is not an application either, but they are switching from 4 to 5 to changes. And I thought, oh, great idea. CK Source, the company, they're doing open source, they're living in Warsaw. Yes, and I thought I'm living in Berlin. I take a bus, go there, visit them, and discuss. Maybe we can do a prototype. Well, it was very interesting. I learned a lot. But they've had the time to provide me the functionality at the moment to get their JSON changes, and I would have mapped it to this. So it's not running yet, but maybe we can come out to something that is really running and could enable other applications that are not yet ODF become an ODF application. So what have you learned so far? Let me summarize here, a little recap. So it's best to not dispatch documents in source code repositories, but dispatch changes. They are changes that are necessary for merging because you don't want to have a change in a position to know where to put it. And it's much better than otherwise you have to compare to documents and find out what has been changed. I don't know. Forget about change tracking. I simply skipped a bit because it's, the general thing is broken. Okay, I'll tell you once. For instance, legal departments in Great Britain are not allowed to lose change tracking because the very huge contract, they make a claim to change, and the other simply reject it, and when it's getting back, you get no notification that something has been rejected. Right? So change tracking is for something like a dictatorship, like Linus Torvald, right? Where you can say, I take it, no, I don't take it, I take it, right? But it's not for peers, okay? It's simply, this concept is broken. It was an afterthought for some customers, but it's not working for legal departments where the money is. So, the last thing is, you can use it also for different feature sets. That's for which user applications with different feature sets, right? For collaborating. Currently, you only load everything and save everything. What you don't know, you should certainly drop. We call it a filter, but it's here. You're losing data. So, there are more data, there are more benefits, like I said. Just the data loss is going, it's getting far faster when I edit a very huge file and I make, I should save it. Currently, I'm saving all the file. It takes quite long, right? But if you only save, if you just edited, then it's far, far easier, far, far faster. Okay. So, and here's my favorite example, is if I'm a favorite author, and put my book, my new book on a server, read only, right? Then you can read it, you can see it, and you see, oh, there's a typo. I wanna suggest the change here. Instead of sending me the full document back, where I have no idea if you have maybe put some jokes into my new book that I'm not aware of, you can send me only the changes, and I can look at it and say, oh, that's true. Like, best I have some tooling. And it shows me now my like change tracking, what's been added and deleted. And you can be fully confidential that there's no loss of data overwriting data. And that's the same thing that the legal departments want with their very large contracts are being changed. And another reason for this example I love so much is you better use positions like 1, 2, 3, like I did, no IDs, because otherwise the author had to put in this read-only document and every possible thing that can be pointed out in ID, it would blow up this document by enlarge. So by conventional configuration, just counting these logical pieces in the document, you save size and you'll be far flexible. And the last thing is, when we do this pointing, we suddenly have a runtime API. You know, ODF applications do not have a runtime API. And whenever can do what he likes, and Starbucks macros, LibreOffice macros, only run in LibreOffice. They're not like JavaScript running everywhere. Why is it possible for JavaScript? Because there's the DOM API, the WCP DOM API. There is a runtime API. So suddenly we have something like this. And what would be the benefits? What is such a runtime API good for? Just look at the browsers. Look how powerful JavaScript has become. For instance, we could have these asset tests. Have I used them? I don't trust the internet. But you open a document and it scales up suddenly to the point of support. Like this browser had 95% of these success. So the test is within the document you're calling, right? It's genius. And why is it possible? Because they have interoperable scripts. Another thing is quite similar is, can I use .com as a page where you can look, may I use this feature already in a certain application, and you can compare the features existing. The nice thing is, currently we're only loading, saving, and look in the document, oh, is it still there, the feature? But with changes, you have the ability to load, change, and then save and see if it's there, right? You're much more powerful. Think about it. On an obvious application says, any ODF specification isn't only a specification, it can load and save valid ODF. Well, it by the way is valid ODF because it just simply sucks it, saves the same thing, and well, nobody can prove it. But with change, it's going to be different. And I wish that, like here, it's also I can compare Office applications by what are the features there, what are they supporting, right? And it's not possible at the moment. There are no features. There, because we cannot test them, and they are more integral features across applications that we compare. And the nice thing, you cannot only test the features of the applications, but you can also test the features of the documents of the customer, right? Because you can run them in this green box, remember, where it sequences to the features that the user write it down, and then you can take a look and make a statistic what features being used and what amount. And by this you can say, oh, this feature set, if only you can use LibreOffice or you can use a simple Vim, whatever. Okay, and last thing, maybe one of the most powerful things, was changing your history, right? Because you can go back and forth in futures, and you have Git support, because you no longer line-based Git is going on, but you have semantics, which is wonderful, because the merge is quite easy. And because there are some developers that would like that you understand why merge is easy, what's the miracle of merge. So I really would like to explain it and bring the basic techniques. So one way, the document was once quite unique. But nowadays, if a document is equal to the sum of changes, there are different ways to create a document. Like the first into an A, position one, I simplified, then a B, then a C, resulting into an A, C. But the second document can be created, if I start with a C, then I said, oh wait a minute, I forgot the B. I inserted the front, okay? But then I went, oh, I forgot the A. And suddenly, I have a totally different document sequence, but it results into the same document. So it seems that both of these sequences are equal. So how do you transform one document to the other sequence? Okay? So, any guess? How can you do it? Okay, let's start with the C. There's an add C. There's in the beginning, and there's an end. Think about it, it's just like a stack, like you write a document. This is a timely map. This is the first operation, this is the last, right? And it seems like you have to switch them, right? So let's say the basic thing that we can do is switch to operations. And if we switch to operations, what are we changing? As I said, this is the timely order. We switch the timely order. It's like it's a time travel. Let's think about the C. If the C is inserted after the B, then suddenly it's behind the C and it's in a position afterwards because something has inserted before. Alright? So this is called, by the way, operation transformation. It was in Google Wave, Apache Wave, something, there are different ways of dealing with it, quite abstract and quite complicated, but from this example you see that all you need is to change the position, right? Because when it's going down, suddenly the A comes first and you can reorder the B. Ah, by the way, we have everything. It's like a bubble sort here, you can do more likely quickly. But remember, you change the timely order of this, and so you can alter the sequence, and the only thing that you have to realize is if I change the position, is something inserted before? Okay. So what happens now if we say I want to take out one of these changes, okay? I don't want the B any longer. What can we do, right? Can we, what's the problem? Just delete the B. No. If we do this, if we just remove the B, then suddenly there's a gap. Okay? So, and you realized by the former thing here with the 111, that even if you add one after the other, the earlier keeping the other becoming the same. It's not like a blockchain directly or a distributed ledger, but you might think about it that they're quite everything that's coming next is dependent on the full state of the previous. Alright? So let's sort it back again. And how do we remove it? Well, when you think about like a card game, you put one change like a card, you can say you're only allowed to remove the card that is top most, right? Because this top card is not influenced by any other. anything, any card below, every change below, is influenced by the ones that are earlier. But you might destroy the influence of the coming next. Okay, that's the reason. Okay, so what are you doing? Only delete the top card, meaning you're only allowed to remove the latest, the top change. How we do it? Again, we simply, wait a minute, wrong thing. We move it on top, and then we will, here we remove it, and here we said, okay, I want to have a system like a blockchain, no change will be deleted ever. So what you can do is simply put in the delete command, and then this is like adding a zero, yes? For every operation or change, there's an inverse operation, neglecting it. Okay? So this is null, and this results out of the document. Okay? Understood? It's not complicated. I mean, it's strange a little bit for the first thing. It's the same thing. But like in school, if you have physics, you know this three-hand rule. Make a very simple example and go for it, like ABC, CB1, and deal a little bit on a piece of paper, and it's getting out very simple. So, the miracle of merge. So now we have a merging, okay? We have user A going over the weekend, sailing on the ocean with no Wi-Fi at all, and writing hello at position 1. And we have user B going in the forest, no Wi-Fi at all, writing at world at position 1. And the server is empty. And the document. They're starting with an empty document, right? It's similar, it's very similar, the process like it, because both are working on branches, right? They have their own, every change is like a commit. And they're stacking it up, and sooner or later, they want to sync with the server. It works for PHP as well, and it's easier to understand with the server. Similarly, Git is a decentralized thing, it can be your computer here, but like GitHub, there's a simplified version, right? You can use PHP things as a server version. So, Blue is the lucky one, comes to the office and says, "Ah, oh, nobody has pushed before, I pushed my change to the server." Great, easy. I love those things. So easy. The server now, the document calls help. Now, later on, B comes to the office and said, "Ah, I want to push my change to the server." Guess what? Of course, error, push. Oh no! Somebody has pushed something in between. So what I have you to do is, you have to pull first, right? So when you pull, you take the server on top, but that's not totally correct because, as I said, rewrite later, and this change was earlier, okay? So you have to move up this change earlier. But if we do so, remember, we influence the position and S becomes and pushes to set. And now I'm allowed to push to the server, which I'm doing now, and ta-da, we have hello world. Okay? And now the wonderful thing, while in software, you got a merge conflict, you're lost. Here, you realize a merge conflict. First thought, like, oh, he's working on a cell, he has deleted the table, just move these changes on a slide, right? And they should deal with it later on, contact these guys. But the merge itself is very easy, just by changing the position. It's like the shell game. Hey, where's my change? Where's my order, right? You're working on a paragraph, and it might be moving a document, but this OT, operational information, keep your track of it. So, you might ask,
yes. You have 5 minutes.
Okay.
I have a question.
Go ahead.
Ask if user B pushes first.
That's exactly what I said. You have no idea. It depends. There can be both header written. It depends who pushed first. Okay? To me, this is a potential merge conflict because two people writing different things at the same position, right? You don't know. You have no semantics control, only these things. I guess I have 8 tossing over that took 2 minutes. Anyway. So another very important thing here is in Git you need hashes, right? How do you do this with the office, which is sometimes one line, sometimes multiple lines, and the XML can change, so the hash will break all the time. But what you should do instead is ignore this semantic model, this abstraction, hash this semantic model. And by this, finding the side effect, most of the doc X files and ODT files, where you simply save the same document as a different file format, have the same semantic tree. So you realize these are semantically the same thing. Okay. So this is very, very important to get this noise under control. So the last thing is how you start on the core feature of LibreOffice, because LibreOffice is from the 80s and it's very hard to embrace something, the concept that it was not by design involved in the 80s. What is the minimum viable product? So the idea is to have, for instance, a signed document that's sent from LibreOffice to LibreOffice. And in the signed document, you have to know that not the zip is signed, but not the document is a zip XML file, but each XML file is being signed. So when you change now something in the document, it's been written in XML, and you break the seal. Okay, the sign, seal, sign. Okay, anyway, you'll see the signature. Okay, but what you can do is you can now have changes. Put the changes aside. Like, you get a contract that's signed, and you say, oh, wait a minute, I got a suggestion here, I would like to do something different. And you write something, and the changes you're doing are just signed as well as changes aside of the document within the zip, a new file. And the funny thing is, the other said, oh, wait a minute, but we have to do something else on that. And he gives it back, that's the usual ping pong of a document, right? And it can be traced now fully what was the way, who has written what at what time, okay? And this can be going on and so on. And that's one full, easy, reachable step for LibreOffice, because you don't have to rewrite configuration, you don't have to erase everything in the first line, and it's an enterprise feature set that you can sell and make like this. So, and it's so cool, why don't we have it already? The problem is, I go here, as I talk to the Foster, the changes are based on the ODF XML, which are complex. When you take a look at the specification, the grammar, is, well, you can't see it right, but more than 18,000 lines, okay? And there are about 600 XML elements and 1,300 XML attributes, which together form elements are like electrons, atoms, elements are atoms, and the attributes of the electrons, and these are making this the feature set like a table. So it's very difficult to read this. And the idea that I followed was, for example, with the table, load this all not in a text-based file but in a graph database. Visualize it. This is only the table document with looks like a star picture. The table document with its children. I zoom a little bit in. These are attributes, red. And this is simplified to this one. And long story short, why are we doing this? Because it's easier to prove something in a graph database, like, can a paragraph be nested? Or show me all the places in the document where a table can exist. And you can, instead of looking to this very huge file, you write a query that you can share with others, and you can nail it down once and for all. And the other thing that's very nice is I want to have, I use the grammar to have the additional information of changes to generate source code, right? Because when we think about it, it's like painting by numbers, okay? If you think you can start over again, then you should generate as much as possible this whole ODF runtime model. And my wish is basically that in 50 years, that collaboration editors become as ubiquitous as text pictures. Well, that's basically all. I'm currently working on this kind of source generation for electric invoices, and I would really love to elaborate this idea. And finally, I can tell, I'm not sure what or if LibreOffice is still a focus for years, but I do know that this color features are good. Okay, thank you for listening.